to the show on Shaw TV. This is episode 115. I am your host, Bisola Alabi, and I'm standing in for Madkara, the regular host. He's away in Europe on vacation. What a lucky guy. But Matt keeps tweeting every 5 minutes about all the beer he's drinking. Come home already, Matt. Well, strumming right away behind me is our musical guest, Shauna Janz, and Martin Marichok on the cello. Now, Shauna is a self-taught guitar player, and she also works as a grief support worker and educator. Now I wonder how much of her work influences her music and vice versa. Well, we'll find out more about that when I interview her later. I have exciting news for you on the show. We've got two new hosts joining us. They are Liz Heinz and Raymond Albert. And it's such a pleasure to have them on the show. Raymond is usually behind the camera and he decided to try his hands on hosting. Way to go, Ray Ray, way to go. And of course, Liz Heinz is not a stranger to the Shaw volunteer family. She used to host way back when, and I actually met Liz about 14 years ago when I first came to town, and Shaw used to do a show called Plugged In, but that was way, way back. Welcome to the show. It's good to have you on the show, Liz. Well, today's show is packed with information and lots of fun stuff. First off, find your inner Merfolk at the Merfolk Splash Mob. This is the challenge of Crimson Coast Dance Society, and Kimberly Plumley will be chatting with Holly Bright of Crimson Coast Dance Society. It's their 18th annual Infringing Festival, and they're gonna have lots and lots of wonderful talents. And guess what? We have Little Mermaid here in the studio with us today. Yay! And right after that, we have Joanne Hogan. She will be interviewing Luc Béger, and he is a longtime participant of the Ride to Conquer Cancer, and it's BC's largest cycling fundraiser. It's an incredible two-day ride, and Luc will fill us in with all the details later. And of course, Liz Heinz and her guests, Chris Borg, Gabriel Cameron, and Tony of the Nanaimo Astronomy Society will be doing a two-part series. In the first half, they will highlight recent activities in the society, how to join, field trips, and upcoming events like beer and burgernight. Yum. And of course, I have a question for you. Do you like to give and you don't quite know how to fit giving into your financial planning? Well, not to worry, Matthew Hoffman and his guest, Nahanni Ackroyd, will be delving deeper into that, and Nahanni will shed more light into making charitable giving a part of your financial plan. These and many more coming up on the show on Shaw TV. Do not go away.
Glad you're watching. I am so excited. I get to talk to Holly Bright today, and we're going to talk about the Infringing Dance Festival, the Merfolk Splash Mob. But I want to say this. Well, hello, Holly.
Hi, Kim.
I know. I knew it was a thing. I'm so excited that you're here. So can you tell me a little bit about Infringing Dance Festival?
It's in its 18th year and 4 days of fantastic cultural dance. So it gives us this great opportunity to learn about some of the most beautiful aspects of the cultures of the people who live here in Nanaimo and really who live in Canada across the country.
Beautiful. It's always a really amazing event. So, and you're also doing it in conjunction with the Save on Foods Memorial, Save on Foods Dragon Boat Festival. Mm-hmm. So that's a really great tie-in together.
It's a fantastic partnership. It keeps the weekend really broad and interesting for lots and lots of different kinds of people. And we essentially provide the entertainment. Our Infringing Dance Festival and the Dragon Boat Festival arrive side by side at Maffeo Sutton Park. We're there from Thursday to Sunday, and they're there from Saturday and Sunday. We have three indoor ticketed shows at the Harbour City Theatre on Victoria Road. And then 3 days of outdoor free dance performances and workshops.
Amazing. Mm-hmm. So there's one that's really cool, something very new to the Infringing. It is our Merfolk
Splash Mob.
Oh my gosh. So we have some amazing Little Mermaids with us, and they are here as courtesy from Headliners Theatre, and they're doing a big show on July 21st. So we really thank these Little Mermaids. So they're gonna show us how a mermaid would move.
Well, we were trying to figure out what the splash mob should be because you have to have choreography, and they've let us know that mermaids,
hello, mermaids,
swish their tails.
Yes, foot.
Are you gonna show us the swishes?
That's
they
it.
They swish their tails.
That's it.
And then they flip their tails.
Yay.
And then they swish their tails again.
These are just some of the great things that we're gonna do in the splash mob.
And they wave.
And they wave.
What else do they do? They sing when they're not shy.
Yeah. Oh, we got the siren song. So we've got Alexis, Peyton, Shyla, and Liliana. They're adorable. And they are just some of it's for all ages. Everybody could be one of the merfolk.
Mermaids, mermen, merbeasts, merfolk. There are lots of different ways you can have a costume and create your own. There are lots out there for sale, and it's even sea punk is happening now, which is kind
of punk.
Yeah, it's dressing punk style only in pastel colors.
And, is that weird? Okay.
Yeah, so there's a place for everyone, and just come on down at 4 o'clock on Sunday, July 10th. It wraps up our festival,
right,
and a really fun time to get together, have some fun together in costume, and get in the water and splash a lot.
Perfect. So who else is coming to Infringing? We've just got a really short time, but who else is coming?
We have a Japanese traditional dance artist who's performing outside, Korean contemporary fusion company from Korea and Victoria. We're bringing an Aboriginal company called Raven Spirit Dance to perform on Thursday night with Nanaimo dancers.
Nice.
And really excited to have the Aboriginal company perform their own stories and create contemporary fusion with their cultural dance. We also have a show called We Don't Need Another Hero, which is about how we as people and individuals operate, whether we operate from our heart, our head, or our gut.
Machine Noisy
is going to work with our local LGBTQ two-spirit identified youth, mm-hmm, to create a piece. And wow, it's just a completely packed weekend. We'll have some African dance, some samba, Caribbean style,
capoeira.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. There's a whole bunch, and it's always really fun down there.
You know what else? We have a dancer who worked in the Central Vancouver Island who's now with Ballet BC, Alexis Fletcher, and she's bringing her choreography here to the festival. So
a
great time to
see her. I'm excited. So what's the dates again?
July 7th to the 10th.
That's right. So it's a full-packed big weekend. We're going to have a lot of fun with that. And I think I might even get Miss Joanne to come hang out with us, maybe do a bit of the merfolk flash mob.
I'm not sure. Unless there's one that comes out all dressed in black, I might be able to do it then. Sounds like a lot of fun, and it's really wonderful to see the mermaids performing for us today and to hear Holly talk about the Infringing Festival. I'm really delighted to present someone I know quite well through the Francophone Association, Luc Béger. He has a lot to tell us about what he does in August of every year for the last 7 years. And what he does is he's involved in a team called Nanaimo Rides Again that takes part in the Right to Conquer Cancer, which is the largest cycling fundraiser in the province, as you may have heard Bisola mention before. And I wanted to start by asking, Luc, what is it that motivated you in the beginning to take part in this?
Well, many years ago, both my parents suffered from cancer. My mother, from the age of when I was born, mm-hmm, she was diagnosed with cancer and went through 14 surgeries for cancer or related to cancer. And then my father died in 1986 from cancer as well. So I decided that I had to do something about it. And in 2010, I met two other friends, Ian Brown and Frederick Robinson. And we decided to start a team here in Nanaimo to raise money for the BC Cancer Foundation.
Wow. And it's the jersey you're wearing now,
exactly,
is the Nanaimo Rides Again.
And it's our seventh year.
Mm-hmm.
And so far, we were able to raise in the neighborhood of $250,000.
That's very great for just this, from this region, right, that you're raising?
Just from our team. There's many teams in Nanaimo.
Mm-hmm.
We're only one of approximately 10 teams in Nanaimo.
Oh, that's really interesting. And the event, of course, I believe it takes place on August?
August 27th and 28th.
Okay.
And we ride from Vancouver to Seattle in 2 days, which is a ride of approximately 250
kilometers. 250
kilometers. Yeah,
so your team must be in great shape. to do this every year and prepare for it every year?
Well, we train probably at least 4 or 5 months before the event, and myself, I ride all year.
Okay, okay, so it's just, you just go with the flow and
exactly.
You're used to, you've got the capacity to take long rides.
So far.
Yeah, and I've noticed that with the presenters of the BC Cancer, BC Ride to Conquer Cancer are Silver Wheaton, and along with your very generous raising numbers, in the province they speak of 70 million have been raised.
70 million since 2008, and over 300 million since 2006, I believe, over all Canada.
On Canada, so this is a big event in terms of fundraising. And can you tell me a bit more about where you start in Vancouver and where you end up in Seattle? What is your journey like for you then?
All riders start in Surrey at Fraser Down. Mm-hmm. And we ride for approximately 125 kilometers to Mount Hood. Mm-hmm. And then from there, we ride to Seattle.
Okay.
And we're approximately anywhere between 2,000 to 3,000 riders taking part in the ride and riding together.
Mm-hmm. And I forgot to mention that we have some photos of previous events. I hope that we can show them still. I neglected to mention that earlier in our conversation, that you have some photos that show previous rides and that. And so this is a real team-forming event. I mean, there are so many of you out together.
There's a lot of riders that ride on their own, and then there are teams. Mm-hmm. We decided to start a team and try to fundraise together, and we ride together.
Okay, okay.
And the team ranges from 8 riders to, a few years ago, there was 35 of us riding together.
All right. Well, that sounds like a wonderful occasion for to really bond working for this great cause. I know I've been at the launch of one of the rides, and it was very moving, the presentations that were made, and I really wish you and your team, the Nanaimo Rides again, the best again, the dates are
August 27th and 28th.
Okay, and of course we've seen on the screen as well that there's a chance for people to make donations online.
Each rider has to raise $2,500 to be to take part in the ride.
Okay, well thank you so much, Luc. Bonne chance.
Thank you.
And now I would like to present once again Shauna Janz. She's going to be performing "Lo and Behold" for us.
Coming from low and say in life that you should shoot for the moon because even if you miss, you'll land amongst the stars or the planets or the galaxies or universes known and unknown. And no one knows more than that than the members of the Nanaimo Astronomy Society. And joining us today are Chris and Gabby to tell us about the society, what you do, how we can join the fun, and how long you've been a society. So Chris, what sparks your interest in astronomy?
It's just understanding what's out there in the night sky. You look up at night and you don't know what you're looking at. So it's nice to have that knowledge and to understand that there's actually some planets up there and lots of other interesting stuff.
Very good. And as a society, what is it that you're hoping to achieve and how do you do that?
We just want to share our passion and knowledge of the night sky with the general public. So we host, we meet monthly. We normally have two presentations. We're nice and friendly, we don't bite. So we have a short presentation and then we'll have a long presentation about some subject of interest. So we're very lucky. We have lots of astronomers that will come up from the Professional Astronomy Association down in Victoria that will come and talk to us. Mm-hmm. So it'll be, for example, we've had talks on Pluto and black holes and gravity waves and all those, that good stuff you never knew you knew what you wanted to know about it.
Beautiful, beautiful. And how many members in the society?
We're just over 80 members at the moment. Mm-hmm. We're a non-profit. We're run by volunteers. Mm-hmm. And I say it's a mix. We have a nice demographic of retired people, sort of middle-aged working folks like me. We have quite a few students from the university.
Very good. Good. And also some women. Gabby, welcome. I understand there's a fundraiser coming up for the society. Tell us a little bit about that and how the funds are used.
Yeah, absolutely. So we are doing a fundraiser coming up on Saturday, July the 9th. Mm-hmm. It's going to be a beer and burger event at the Wellington Pub from 4 to 7 p.m. Anyone can come and get tickets right at the door, nice and easy. And we are raising some money to try and update our current equipment for our outreach events. We like to go out in the community and, you know, provide some outreach for our community members, and we're just trying to get our equipment
very good. And I believe we have some photos to show of some of the events in the community that you do. And what are some of the highlights of some of those events that you've done or upcoming ones that we should know about?
Okay, well, we actually have Canada Day coming up. We'll have a stall set up down at Mafiasetan Park by the bridge where we'll have some of our special solar telescopes set up. So you can see the sun, you can see solar flares, which are quite impressive to look at.
So daytime viewing.
Daytime viewing,
yeah,
yes.
Yeah, very good.
And our big event, probably our biggest event ever in the club's history, will be on Monday night where we'll have Bob McDonald from... host of CBC's Quirks and Crocs.
Canadian science icon, Bob McDonald. Awesome.
We'll be presenting to us on Monday night. Mm-hmm. That's a ticketed event for the public, so you can buy tickets online or at the door.
Very good.
He'll be talking about his life in space journalism and his conversations with the three Canadian astronauts who've spacewalked.
How exciting. Mm. And there's information on your website for people who want to get tickets.
Yep.
We're showing the website on the
yep.
show.
Yep.
And so you meet monthly, and that's at Bevan Park, is it?
Yes, we meet at the social complex in Bevan Park. Mm-hmm. Rooms 1 and 2.
Very good. And so anybody's welcome to join. You don't have to have a science background.
Nope. We have a nice mix of members. You know, people just have a general interest. Probably only less than a half hour members own a telescope.
And Flat Earth Society folks, they're welcome to join as well.
Well, yes, they come from all over the globe.
Okay. Everybody's welcome.
Yes.
You'd like a good debate now and then, too. Flat Earth,
yep.
Round Earth, who
yep.
knows, right?
Yeah.
Very good. Well, good luck with the beer and burger event at the Well. And good luck with your event with Bob McDonald,
Thank
the
you.
Canadian science icon. That's
Thank
exciting.
You.
Okay. And now I'm going to send it over to Matthew for some charitable giving of another kind.
Hi, I'm here with Nahanni Ackroyd from Freedom 55. Financial investment, and we're here to talk about charitable giving and how it can be. I'm a part of a financial plan, so I understand there's a lot of different ways that we can provide charitable giving. Can you please tell us how this is a benefit to people?
Yeah, absolutely, Matthew. So a lot of what happens is people plan on an annual basis for charitable giving. They'll donate to their favorite charities, they'll get a tax receipt, they can apply it to their taxes, get a tax credit for it. What you can start to do is do a little bit more planning and think about what your terminal tax return is going to look like. So we call that estate planning. We start to look at what are the financial implications over time of your, say, portfolio growing, and then how charitable giving might be a way to offset the taxes owing at the end.
Well, that's great. And how does this actually work?
So, for instance, there's been a couple, they've saved hard, their money has grown, they've saved $1 million in RSPs. One of them dies, the RSPs all go to one, the last person. that last person now has $1 million in RSPs. When they die, it triggers a tax bill of about $500,000. And so now that money is going into Canadian general revenue. Instead, they could stop and look at their plan ahead of time and go, you know what, if we donate that $500,000, we can decide what charities we want our money to go to directly, and it can offset that tax bill.
Well, that's awesome. That's great to know, right, for a lot of people that go through these struggles and what they can do with their money. So as it is interesting, how is this going further can help people?
Yeah, absolutely. There's different ways. Obviously, it depends on the individual situation. Not everybody has $1 million in RSPs, but they may have some want to give in some way. So talking with a financial advisor, they might want to go, oh, you know what? There's different products that meet my needs. Mm-hmm. Right now, you can name a charity as a beneficiary on certain products, and that money will go directly to the charity instead of going through your will. So depending on the product, you can also choose to products that will bypass probate, and by doing that, they reduce the taxes owing and they reduce your probate fees at the end as well.
That's awesome. And what sort of securities do they get?
Well, there is an option to people can donate securities. So say they've invested in something in a stock and it's grown well over time. Now they've got a huge capital gain bill. If they donate that stock, they'll get a tax receipt for the entire amount and the capital gains doesn't get triggered on it. So being strategic when you're starting to look at that final plan really works.
Well, that's great. And how does someone decide if this is the right thing for them?
That's a really good question, too. It's not for everybody, but for the people that want to give, and a lot of Canadians do want to give, it's what we like to do, is talking to a financial advisor who's interested in charitable giving so that they've got someone who's aligned with their ideas, and then talk to the charity as well. Mm-hmm. A lot of people miss talking to the charity. They've come up with some great idea, and they donate money to a charity. They can't possibly do whatever it was that the person had intended. So talk to the charity, see what kind of gifts they can accept. Can they do what you want to do? Do you want to be recognized publicly while you're alive, after you're gone? Do you want to be an anonymous donor alive or after you're gone as well?
Awesome. Well, I do want to thank you for coming onto the show. We have run out of time, and this was a great conversation and a lot of things for people to look into. I'm going to throw it to Bisola for a recap. Thank you.
Welcome to the second half of the 115th episode of the show on Shaw TV. Wait a minute. I see the moon. I see stars, I see celestial beings. Well, lovers of astronomy, this is for you. Moving on to the last half of the two-part interview, Liz Heinz and her guest will take the astronomy talk a step further by showing us some telescopes and how they are used. After that, Raymond Albert, Mr. Ray Ray himself, will fill you in on what's going on in the Harewood community. His guests, Peggy Lake and Chris Lee, will keep us posted about plans to create a skate park in Harewood community. Isn't that exciting? Their very own skate park. That's going to be fun. Also, stay tuned for all things Shauna Janz, her music, her work, and upcoming events. And you know, they say image is everything, and that is really true because a photograph will capture 100 words in one shot. And Kimberly Plumley will be chatting with Dirk Heidemann. Now, Dirk says his name Heidemann rhymes with vitamins, just so you remember. So Dirk Heidemann of HA Photography will give you lots of photography tips. And of course, do not relegate yourself to just singing in the shower. Why should you? The Vancouver Island Symphony believes that everybody should sing a song they love. So they're holding a public audition for the choir, and Joanne Hogan and Patricia Plumley will tell us more about that. So clear your throats, lick some halls, and get your singing voices ready. And do you know anybody building myths like weight training stunts your growth, or you're supposed to just train one part of the body a day at a time? So say chest training on Monday, leg training on Tuesday. Well, our very own fitness expert, Casey Scott, is here with a bodybuilding husband and wife duo, Pat and Dolly Skiles, and they will tell us about weight training myths, and after that, they will do some demos about common lifts in training. I personally cannot wait to see that because I need some muscles. Anyway, that and many more coming up on the show on Shaw TV. Over to you, Liz.
Thank you, Bisola. And yes, look at these magnificent telescopes we have here. Chris is back from the Nanaimo Astronomy Society. He's the president, and joining him is Tony, the vice president of the society. Gentlemen, please describe what you have brought out tonight. This is awesome.
Yep, this is my baby. This is a special telescope just for looking at the sun. It's called a hydrogen alpha telescope. It only lets through a very narrow bandwidth of light, and you can see all the surface details on the sun. You can see sunspots. You can see solar flares. Those are impressive because they're enormous. So, you know, suffice to say, you should never look at the sun normally, but for this, through this right. telescope, you can.
Oh, so what will I see when I look through here?
Well, you'll see the sun.
Oh,
hopefully, there you go.
Awesome.
So we'll have this out for Canada Day, hopefully, as weather permitting. We'll have several Shirley telescopes out. So we invite the members of the public to come down to see all the stalls on Canada Day, and they'll better see the sun directly with their own eyes.
At Matthew Sutton Park?
Yeah, Matthew Sutton
very,
Park.
And are these very weatherproof? Or?
No, you don't want to get them wet.
No.
So only meant to be used for, you know, outdoors in dry weather.
Very good. Oh, that's awesome. And Tony, what's this beast?
Well, this one I'm proud of because it's bigger than Chris's telescope, but his is much more specialized. This can be used for viewing anything, the stars, the moon, the planets. And at the moment, it's set up for photography. So I have a camera that I've put on the back of the telescope. And so a lot of the pictures that are on the Nanaimo Astronomy Society website were taken by amateur astrophotographers that would be using a camera
so
like this.
So the images that we look through here.
That's right. Yeah, exactly.
We're captured on there.
Right.
Yeah.
But
very
sometimes
good.
The pictures take up to 10, 15 minutes to expose. And so that's the reason for all this gizmo here.
For the stability?
It's stability for one thing, but then also because the Earth is constantly turning,
right.
the stars and the planets appear to move across the sky. And so what happens is the telescope will track the stars, and then you can do a long exposure.
So on that long exposure, is this actually moving itself?
Yes, it's just very slowly moving. It would take like one day for it to complete a full revolution.
Wow.
But it basically just, when you look through the telescope or you take a picture, the star will just be frozen in place.
Beautiful. And what's one of the more exciting places you've actually used these telescopes at, like any lunar eclipses or solar eclipses?
Yeah, there was a solar eclipse, an incredible one, a few years ago back in 2014, and then there was a super moon lunar eclipse that
Beautiful.
Happened last year in September, and we had a huge crowd out for that.
Where did you all gather for that?
Well, for us, I mean, we were trying to figure out where the moon would be visible. Mm-hmm. It's tough around Nanaimo because there's so many hills and mountains, but we picked Departure Bay because we had a nice view to the east out over the lighthouse and things like that, and it was a gorgeous evening, just
Beautiful.
Perfect for that.
Beautiful. Yeah. So if people wanted to join, they could go on some of these field trips with you as well.
That's actually one of
the
greatest things.
Or the night watching,
Yeah, for sure. It's a great way before you think of even buying a telescope. You should come out to one of the events, try one of them out, see if it's something you're even interested in, and before you make that commitment.
That sounds exciting. And I understand you can also teach people how to build a telescope, which is a really good reason to join in and of itself.
Yeah.
So that's very exciting. Thank you, gentlemen, for bringing this magnificent equipment. We look forward to seeing it at one of the meetings.
Yeah, okay, great.
And now we're going to head over to Raymond, who's going to be bringing in some other guests for us.
Thanks, Liz. All right, this is a shout out to all you BMXers, rollerbladers, and skaters out there. We're going to talk about something that took 15 years in the making in the Harewood area. And to tell us all about it is Peggy Lakes from the part of the Harewood Neighborhood Association, and then Chris Lee, who's also part of the Nanaimo Skateboarders Association. Together, they decided to basically join with the Harewood Centennial Park improvement plan to create a skate park, which is a part of the youth parks program. Peggy, why did you guys decide to create this skate park?
Well, we have so many skateboarders. It's tremendous the amount that we have, and they have no place to go to practice their sport. And they go to the malls, they go to the schools, and it's not safe for them, and it's too far for some of them to go. They just can't get to the other skate parks in Nanaimo.
Okay, I know that in Nanaimo there are only two skate parks that are available. One is called The Bowl, that's located behind the curling club, and the other one is also known as The Pioneer, which is behind the Cabela's, Old Canadian Tire. And so where's this new one going to be created?
The new Harewood Skate Park is going to be built behind John Barsby School off of Howard Ave. We hope that construction, if everything goes well, will start in 2017 of phase one. We'd like to take this chance to thank all our sponsors from the community that have helped with our fundraising through the Take It to the Park skateboard contest series. Thank you to Woodgrove Chrysler, Pepsi Canada, United Rentals, and Tom Lee Music for all their support through the last 3 years of fundraising.
And what has happened so far?
So far, 3 years ago, the Nanaimo Skateboard Association joined the Harewood Neighborhood Association to, in their fundraising efforts towards the Harewood Centennial Park Improvement Plan. Our associations, along with the City of Nanaimo, are working with New Line Skate Parks to design and build the new Harewood Skate Park. We have received three concepts from New Line so far.
This is the first one. This is similar, but a little bit different. And this is the third one.
In our roundtable meetings with our skateboard team, we've combined aspects from each of the designs to create a skate park unique to Vancouver Island. We're currently waiting for the final cost and model from New Line for the new Harewood Skate Park.
And so basically, what is needed to complete this wicked park? Like, what do you guys need?
We already have approval of funding from the city, and several sponsors are looking to help us out. And we're looking for the community to help us out here in support and fundraising and to get this really going for the kids.
Okay, so how can we, the people, you know, support this wonderful program?
To realize our goal, we need to fundraise aggressively. If you're interested in contributing, you can do so in four different ways. Donations can be made to the City of Nanaimo under the Harewood Skate Park if you would like a tax receipt. Donations can also be made through the Nanaimo Skateboard Association's GoFundMe page under the Harewood Skate Park. Also, donations can be made through the Harewood Neighborhood Association Facebook page, or donations can be made at any of the three Take It to the Park skateboard contest series events that are going to be taking part later in the summer.
Right on. Well, there you have it, BMXers, rollerbladers, and skateboarders. This is your chance to basically donate to a wonderful cause, to a really cool skate park in Harewood. Now back to you, Bisola.
Welcome back. You're still watching the show on Shaw TV, and right now I am hanging out with our musical guest, Shauna and Martin. How are you doing, Martin?
Real well.
That's a cool cello you have there.
It is.
Yeah, I wish my son was here right now. He would strum away on a cello. He's almost four, and he goes, I love cello. Okay, so Shauna, you are a self-taught guitar player. Mm-hmm. Of all the musical instruments in the world, why did you choose to learn to play the guitar?
I wish I could play all the musical instruments in the world. I actually started off, I bought a bass, and I was learning bass, and I realized I had more melody in me. And mm-hmm. so my dad had an old guitar that he played when he was a boy, and I picked it up and just started teaching myself and strumming and starting to finger pick, and it just allowed me to sing. Also, I realized I had a voice that wanted to also be expressed.
Yeah,
so
you do have a beautiful voice.
Thank you, thank you. Yeah, so I've kind of forayed a little bit into piano a little bit now too, but guitar is definitely my main instrument.
So lyrical, soulful, and warm are some of the few words that people have used to describe your music.
Mm-hmm.
How do you describe your music?
I always have troubles with this question, actually, with genres, or I guess I'm indie folk, singer-songwriter. I like the word soulful. A lot of my music is not only drawn from my own life experiences, but also the work I do in the world, supporting others through grief and hardship, and really finding the resilience and the strength in each other. And so my hope is that my music is heartfelt and soulful and can provide maybe even some healing experiences for other people. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I was reading up on you online, and you have an interesting job.
Yeah.
You are a grief support worker and educator.
Yes.
So you help people through any kind of loss, whether the loss of a loved one,
yes,
loss of a job, any kind of loss
any
whatsoever.
Kind of loss. Yeah.
So How much influence does your work have on your music and vice versa?
Absolutely, they go hand in hand. My passion in life is to be creating more community around experiences that we all go through that cause pain. I feel like we live in a society right now that doesn't give us a lot of room to be with our grief. Mm-hmm. And we need to bring community back to that. And I know that music, creative expression, and connecting through times of hardship are two things that are coming together in my world more and more. So whether it's a reflection of my own life experiences or influenced by the stories that I hear and the support that I'm giving and learning from other people.
Yeah, that's very cool. Mm-hmm. Now, you released an EP in 2014 titled Redwood, and this earned you a Song of the Year nomination in the 2015 Island Music Festival.
Yeah.
Now you just released a new album titled Wriggle Heart, and you're having a CD launch on the 23rd of June.
Yes. That one's in Victoria.
Yes, that's very exciting.
It's very exciting. Yeah, this is my first solo full-length album. I'm really proud of it. It was released on June 10th, so it's available now on my website. And I'll be playing here in Nanaimo at the Dinghy Dock on, I believe it's June 28th, Tuesday.
Okay.
Yeah, so for anyone that's interested and likes what they're hearing today, we'd love to see you there.
That'd be nice. Mm-hmm. And listen, if you want to know about other of Shauna's upcoming shows, just go to her website and check out where she's playing. Right now, I'm going to throw things over to you, Shauna.
Cool.
And you're going to sing a song titled Light and Stardust.
Great.
Take it away, Shauna.
Yeah, thank you.
Through my veins, calling me back to my roots again. Fire and water, marrow and bone, feed my soul and bring me home. I am the universe, the universe is us, forever joined by light and stardust. Listen to the rhythm, for everything it speaks, I am you and you. Joined by light. are me.
Thank you.
Exciting. That is amazing. Your voice is amazing. Thank you. I want to give a shout out to all our camera people here on the show. Amazing things. Yay! Yeah. Hi, Charlotte. Yay! So because I want to talk about cameras, we're going to talk to Dirk Heidemann. He's going to talk about cameras. We're going to talk a little bit about why we have headshots. Hi, Dirk. How
Hi,
are
Kimberly.
You?
I'm great, thanks.
I'm so excited you're here. So we're going to talk about headshots, the photos, not the hockey hits, right? Yeah, so we're not going to do that. That's as close as I get to any hockey humor. So tell me a little bit about how many headshots have you done, do you think?
Countless. Thousands.
Really?
Thousands, yeah.
So you kind of know your stuff.
I've done a few.
Just a few. That's right. Okay, so why do people need a good headshot?
I think one of the main reasons is it's one of the first ways that we see people.
Right.
Is either on Facebook, LinkedIn, on a resume. It's oftentimes our first interaction with someone.
Right.
And that photo can say a lot about who you are. And I think it's important to make a really good, strong impression the first time around. So having a good photograph of yourself, represent yourself, will go a long ways.
Good. So we have a couple shots that we're going to show people, right? And we're going to do that. So I think we're going to queue up one of those right now. Which one? Oh, we've got that beautiful one.
Oh,
it's over
Sean
there. Yeah, Sean, yeah, yeah. So tell me about that one, because that really invokes a feeling, doesn't it?
I had about 20 minutes to have Sean in my studio. He was rushing off to another event, and he had such a great presence with him. It was actually a very easy shoot at my end. He just, that presence, I just had to throw some good light on him, and he brought everything forward. It's great when you have people
beautiful.
Like that.
Okay,
yeah.
And then we have another one. Oh, lovely.
And that's Ellen White, and that was during, she received the Jubilee Award for that image, and it was just a really quick, happy snap, but it just sort of captured, again, her presence and all that she's done for our community.
So headshots don't have to be staged, they can be in that moment too,
they
right?
They can be, although yeah. It's nice to have a bit of time to actually stage something. That's actually, I wouldn't say that's actually a headshot, that was just something that we captured.
Gathered, yeah, that's
yeah.
Right. So we know that people use them for various things. So what are some tips that you would give people for a decent headshot?
Yeah. Great question. I always think it's important to have a good night's sleep beforehand so you're not looking...
Okay.
Yeah, you know what I mean.
Yeah, yeah.
And wear clothes that represent you. So if you're a business person, you want to have a business outfit. And it should be clean, wrinkle-free, no heavy patterns, no stripes, no logos. And bring your A-game to it, you know.
Nice.
It's yeah.
Nice, okay. So what about hair and makeup? Because, you know, that's my thing too, right?
Hair and makeup's good to always have professional hair and makeup done if you can afford it or swing
right.
it. Yeah.
Right, okay. So let's see another photo that Dirk did. What? Oh, look at this one.
Denise at the conference.
Oh, Denise.
Yeah, she's awesome. And we just, that's Denise. Like, she's always like on her phone. She's always really busy. But whenever you catch her, she's always got a smile. So that
yeah.
was kind of an impromptu shot, but it worked out
okay.
really well.
Another one that we have coming up. Oh,
this is
Paul.
This is Paul. This is actually my assistant. We were doing a cover for the Gateway magazine, and the model had shown up, and something fell through. He wasn't able to do it. And we all looked at Paul, and he had those glasses and that shirt, and we were looking for sort of that antique, that look of from the past.
Right.
And, we said, Paul, we need you. And he says, no way. But we coaxed him into it, and it turned out to be a great shot. He was perfect for it.
Perfect. So, okay, we're going to wrap up, but I'm really excited because I always learn more from you. And lighting, you're always really key on lighting and really exciting. So you are a great photographer. So excited
Thanks,
to Kimberly. Have you in our town because you are definitely part of our community because you're always out there doing photos and things.
I'm busy, and it's a great community to be working in.
Oh, we're lucky. Lucky us. So we're going to head over to lovely Joanne, and Joanne is actually going to be talking to my sister-in-law. I'm really excited. Hi, Patricia. Hi.
Well, thank you very much, Kim. As you can tell, there's an abundance of Plumleys here, which is a good thing. It's a good thing. So, good evening. How are you doing,
Hi,
Patricia?
Joanne. I'm very well, thanks.
I want to read a little bit of the script says here, everybody needs to sing a song they love. Anything works. expand.
That is right. I've just been in six or seven schools within the district, auditioning over 100 children to come into our two levels of children's choir, the grade 5 choir and the grade 6, 7, and 8 children's choir. Okay. And what that says is everyone needs to come into their audition singing something they just can't wait to sing for me. Okay. That shows their voice the way they like it, that makes them feel happy about themselves. Mm-hmm. And I've heard everything from happy birthday to Santa wants a hippo for Christmas. So it's just been a real treat.
So you're constantly entertained. What an interesting
I love it. It's my favorite part of the year is watching all these little people come and present their voices. Yes. We're a little harder on the adults. Mm-hmm. The adults need to come with choral experience and they need to bring something that shows range and everything about their voice.
Okay.
And I give them sight singing, which is never their favorite thing, but that's all right. Mm-hmm. They all make it through and eventually we all have fun.
Okay. Now, you've described the band Fabulous Fives. Those are the ones that are in grade 5, is that correct?
Those are the grade 5s.
The choir,
Choir, yeah.
And the VIS children's choirs are?
6, 7, 8.
Okay. And the VIS Symphonic Choir is the adult
16
one.
And over.
Okay. And how long do these auditions continue and what do they lead to?
The auditions are ongoing. We'll probably go back into a couple of schools just before the end of June. But anyone who wants to is welcome to contact the symphony office. Mm-hmm. They'll get a hold of them and tell them when our next date is and I'll look forward to hearing them sing.
Okay. And where do they typically go through the auditioning or rehearsal?
We're at the North Nanaimo Town Center.
Okay.
And they're our wonderful sponsor and we have a great space there and gives us lots of room to have fun, to move around when we're singing.
Okay. So tell me more about what kind of shows result from all this auditioning and
what we're doing is taking the wonderful training that's already going on in the schools and we're moving that ahead and putting them into professional situations. We have a Christmas show, we have education shows with Rick Scott in February, and we have an exciting new piece that's being written by Pierre Simard, the conductor of the orchestra,
and
for
that
April.
Will be the adult choir that will work with Pierre on this one?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And I'm interested more about you were saying the education show in February. What does that involve?
That's a show that's set up and been put together by Nico Rhodes and Rick Scott.
Nico. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know Nico is.
And it introduces all the grade 4s in the district to the instruments of the orchestra.
Okay.
And the grade 5s are on stage singing with it. So that's what they're auditioning for.
Oh, well, that sounds wonderful.
Yeah.
Well, it's been terrific hearing about all of what you do, and you do this every year.
We do.
And I wish you the best of luck in as you go and discover all these wonderful new talents
Thank
in our
you,
area.
Joanne.
A pleasure with Patricia. And now I would like to throw to Casey. She's going to be chatting with bodybuilders. It sounds very interesting.
Thank you, Joanne. I am very excited to be here today with Pat and Dolly Skiles. Pat won the Canadian Bodybuilding Championship in 2004, and Dolly has won several powerlifting, bodybuilding, and strongman competitions. And she is currently getting ready to compete yet again. Welcome to the show, you guys.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Pat, start by just kind of clearing up some of the myths about bodybuilding. Are you going to go to the gym 3 times a week and look like that?
No. No, Dolly's been training for the better part of 20 years. She's been competing, for 16. It's something that takes time to build that much muscle. It's not something that happens overnight, even for the most genetically blessed. It's something that takes years and years and years of hard, dedicated work.
It's a lifestyle.
Exactly.
Yes. I can imagine diet is absolutely a huge part of it.
About 70%.
But let's talk about cheat days, because you always have an interesting concept there.
Yeah. Cheat days are highly important insofar as that your body adapts to a diet when you're trying to lose body fat. So in order to maintain the fat loss of about 2 pounds a week, you need to have a day or even a meal that's very, 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 very high calorie. So it stops your body from adapting. It actually causes your body to start producing more of the hormones your body needs, thyroid hormone and whatnot, to maintain the body fat loss so your body doesn't start storing body fat and using muscle tissue as fuel.
Well, there you have it. Thumbs up from a pro on cheat days. Dolly, tell us, you have competition coming up in July.
I'm representing BC for the Canadian Championships, and the winner gets a pro card. So I'll be competing for money instead of just prizes.
And a pro card is huge when
you're
in this.
It turns me from an amateur to a professional bodybuilder.
So how long before a competition do you really start training?
I never stop training. That's why I look the way I do. You can't stress that enough, that I never stop training. I don't just train while I'm getting ready for a show. I'm training like this 20, like every day, you know. So it never stops. It never stops.
It's a darn good thing you get those cheat days, hey? That's a good thing for you.
It changes up his diet a little bit.
So another really important thing along with diet and the commitment to the amount of hours you put in at the gym. I have the pleasure of working with these two at the Nanaimo Athletic Club. I see the amount of time and effort that goes into it. But there's also a lot of time you're hiding in that back room with your coach. You're posing.
Yeah, posing
is huge.
Yeah, it really is. It'll take a good physique and basically it'll allow good physique to win a show or lose a show. If you can't pose, if you can't display what you got, you're not going to be able to do well. And a lesser physique will beat you.
And you mentioned how exhausting posing is.
Absolutely. If you just think about holding every muscle in your body tight for even 5 seconds, you'll know how hard posing is because every muscle is tight when you're posing.
Can you show us a pose or two? One of the common popular ones?
I'll show you a front double.
Your front double bicep, and what this does is displays arms, chest, legs. When she's not wearing a shirt and obviously a posing suit, abdominals and whatnot. Okay, relax. Okay, and this will be a rear double bicep. There's other poses as well, but this shows everything from the back. So again, still arms, shoulders, back, her hamstrings, her calves, the whole back part of her body, glutes.
Yeah. We have probably enough time for one or two exercises. We brought some dumbbells there. These aren't close to what she'd be lifting at the gym, but I had to pack them from home, so.
They're not close.
What can you give us?
Can you show you some side laterals?
We've got 30 seconds.
Okay.
So these side laterals for the medial delt right here. Okay. And these are exercises you can do at home.
No space, minimal equipment.
Yeah. Matter of fact, I won my first bodybuilding contest as a junior with a 110-pound weight set, and that was all the equipment I had in my house.
So we'll get one more exercise out of you.
Squats.
And Pat, can you tell us what advice would you give to somebody who's looking into possibly competing?
Talk to somebody who has competitive experience. Somebody that coaches, but also has had competitive experience and has stood on stage. They can best look at your physique and tell you what you're best suited to go into, because there's a lot of different divisions.
Excellent.
And not, yeah.
And if people want to find you?
You can find me at Nanaimo Athletic Club, obviously, along with Casey. I've got a website, patrickscales.com. And
there's a photo op.
Yeah, and you can Pat and Dolly at shaw.ca.
Well, thank you both so much for being here today.
Thank you.
And
for having
best
us.
Of luck to you and your competition, Dolly.
Really, really buff. If I had like 1/10 of your muscles, I'll be set for life.
Well, we have come to the end of this episode of the show on Shaw TV. A big thank you to all our guests, our musical guests, and all the volunteer hosts and those behind the camera. Thanks for making this show a great success. Please visit our Facebook page on facebook.com/theshowonshaw and also Shaw TV Central Vancouver Island's YouTube page to watch previous episodes and also leave comments. If you have any event stories or causes that are near and dear to your heart and you'd like to be a guest on this show, send an email to our executive producer, Kate Bergen, at k.bergen@sjrb.ca. And if you want to volunteer, I would love to have you come on board. Send an email to our volunteer coordinator, Melissa Hall, at melissa.hall@sjrb.ca. Thank you once again for hanging out with us on the show. Now I'm going to leave you with one last song from our musical guest, Shauna Janz, and it's titled Heart and Soul. Take it away, Shauna.
Thank you. These days, you're gonna find your feet with roots in the ground. You're gonna learn to run free, 'cause all you know is what you've been told, and all you see is what you hope. To be.
these days, you're gonna find your wings. Look up to the sky, you're gonna fly so freely, 'cause all you know is what you hold in your heart, and all you see is what you believe. Your life is meant to be. Of salt, crisp, cool air, and clouded mountain tops. She breathes in life for her soul. She breathes in life for all of those who came before. Who came you showed to the world, and all you showed was how to live a life of heart and soul, of heart and soul, of heart and soul, heart and soul.
Thank you.